Okay, so human naman yung tagpaniod to. Conference na nagtumo nga pagpaila-ila sa atong bagong secretary sa National Anti-Poverty Commission ug ang mga programa ni ini. So sa pagpadayon, may acknowledge our friends from the media nga puyog nato karon. So we have from the Freeman, Aldo Ganaynal, please stand to be recognized. Si Rosalie Abatayo from CDN Digital, Inquirer.net. We have Moira Zamora from the Freeman. Aubrey Jimenea from Manila Bulletin. Jim Ray Biosa from DYAR, Cebu. Bong Galarpe from PNA, Cebu. Jason Morata from from a blogger. Salamat. Sa inyong paghatag og panahon aning atong press conference karon. Of course, I would also like to introduce po atong mga kauban sa NAPC from the NAPC communications team, our lead person, Chris Sabal, and also the legal consultant, Attorney Estandarte. And of course, the rest dili mga na sila, kauban nato sa ground team, no, sa NAPC na dito. Okay, and of course, our loan panel, the lead convener and secretary of the National Anti-Poverty Commission, Attorney Noel Felongco. But before I give the floor to him, let me share with you a bit about him. So, si Attorney Felongco is a son of Mindanao. So, he was born in Davao City, grew up in Orala, South Cotabato, and finished his Bachelor of Laws in Cotabato City at the Notre Dame University. He served as president of the Partido Democratico Pilipino Laban ng Bayan, PDP Laban Central Visayas Chapter. Attorney Felongco also served as a counselor for two terms of Cotabato City from 1998 to 2004. He also served as the NCIP during the term of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo from 2008 to 2010 as one of the commissioners. He was appointed by President Duterte as Undersecretary for Solid Waste Management at the Department of Environment and Natural Resources. And prior to being appointed as the lead convener of the National Anti-Poverty Commission, he served as the Chairman CEO of the Presidential Commission for the Urban Poor from February 2018 to October 2018, where he was able to craft the five-year development plan of PCUP and the manual of operations of the agency in his short but effective stint as the chairman. Attorney Noel Felongco was appointed by President Duterte as the lead convener of the National Anti-Poverty Commission last November of 2018. Let's welcome Attorney Noel Felongco, the secretary and lead convener of the National Anti-Poverty Commission. Attorney.
Salamat, Kadoris. Mayong buntag ganin yung tanan. I'd like to give my warmest thanks to all kay kabalo ko nga very short notice pero all out ang support karon sa Cebu Media, no? Sa atong press conference. The purpose of this press conference is for us to make ourselves known to the Cebu media, particularly ang akong ahensya na ang National Anti-Poverty Commission. In my 4 months in the commission, I have observed that many people are really ignorant or have no idea about my agency, no? So that's why we have devised a plan to really inform all Filipinos about the National Anti-Poverty Commission, because truly I believe that my agency has to play an important role in our government, especially in the task to really reduce or eradicate poverty in the country. So, NAPC was created or was established by Republic Act number 8425. And the mandates of NAPC are as follows: to act as the coordinating and advisory body that exercises oversight functions in implementing the social reform agenda and ensure that it is incorporated into the formulation of national, regional, sub-regional, and local development plans. Number two, to institutionalize basic sector and NGO participation in managing the social reform agenda cycle. Third, to develop microfinance by establishing the People's Development Trust Fund and strengthening the People's Credit and Finance Corporation as the forerunners of microfinance services. And fourth, to strengthen LGUs so that they can incorporate the social reform agenda in their social or local development efforts. I think you have that in your kit. Okay? So, the ultimate goal of NAPC is really to contribute in the realization of President Rodrigo Duterte's instruction to lower down the poverty incidence in the country. We have right now the poverty incidence, which is 21.6% as of 2015 survey, and the president has instructed that it must be lowered down to 14% or much lower than 14% in 2022, no? And we are also contributing to the fulfillment of the ambition natin 2040, which is the vision of the president to fully eradicate poverty in the country by 2040, that the Philippines will be transformed into a progressive middle class society, and all Filipinos will be given comfortable life, that nobody will be left behind by the economic gains that we have experienced right now in the country, no? So yun po, as you heard a while ago, sa number 2 mandate sa atong NAPC nga to institutionalize basic sector and NGO participation in managing the SRA cycle. This setup in the government is very unique. Kay dire lang nato makita sa balaod sa NAPC nga embedded na gyud ang participation sa atong basic sector. And the law actually has identified 14 basic sectors. No, and these basic sectors are as follows: the farmers and landless rural workers, artisanal and landless fisher folks, urban poor, indigenous peoples, formal labor and migrant workers, workers in the informal sector, women, children, youth and students, senior citizens, persons with disabilities, victims of disasters and calamities, non-government organizations, and cooperatives. And I assume office in NAPC last November 12, last year, because the former secretary and the convenor, Lisa Masa, resigned. So from the Presidential Commission for the Urban Poor, I was appointed by President Rodrigo Duterte to assume as the Secretary and Lead Convenor of NAPC. And upon or a day after my assumption, I met all the personnel of NAPC. NAPC, by the way, has only 50 regular employees and 100 plus contractuals. So, gamay ra kayo ang opisina sa NAPC. Actually, it is only based in Manila, in Quezon City. No, but we are covering the whole nation or the whole Philippines. No? Dako ang trabaho sa NAPC, but then doon na may problema sa among work complement or manpower complement. No? However, that will not deter us from really doing our task. So, immediately, we devise a plan and programs to really comply with the instruction of the President that by 2022, the poverty incidence in the country will be 14% or much lower. And by 2040, no, there will be 0% of poverty in the country. So we devise a program which we call Sambayanihan Servisyong Sambayanan or SSS, or sometimes we call this as the 3S. So this program is our convergence program adapting the approach of whole of the nation or whole of the government. Meaning, it's not only NAPC, it's not only the Office of the President, or it's not only the Department of Agriculture, but together, all the national agencies, including the local government units, will go to the areas which are considered poorest of the poor to serve those unserved and underserved. So the resources of the government will be brought together by all the agencies of the national and local government units to the poorest of the poor in the country. No? So, the program will answer the need to alleviate and reduce poverty, and it is actually based on developing rural and urban agriculture and industry as the most important preconditions for overcoming extreme poverty. No? So, the program consists of the following basic components. Number one, providing ISF and the urban poor with basic services and access to climate responsive dwelling, livelihood, and employment. Second, developing innovative infrastructure and financing mechanisms to the rural poor. Third, strengthening the rural urban agro economic value chains. Fourth, securing the health and general well-being of poor communities. Fifth, enhancing food security, and last but not the least, Mindanao Special Development Program. Okay, so that's the SSS or Sambayanihan Servisyong Sambayanan. No? So Sambayanihan, why? Because we want to popularize again the concept of bayanihan in our country, no? Because alam naman, kabalo naman mo nga murag na kalimtan na nato ning bayanihan, di ba? Murag individualistic na magdita kaayo. So we need to bring back again the culture of working together, no? Not only in our families, in our communities, but also in the government, no? So under Sambayanihan, Servisyong Sambayanan, the government as a whole, in coordination with the private sectors, especially with the business sector, and third, sa atong 14 basic sectors, will be working together to alleviate the living condition of our poor in the country. And we devise a mechanism para kining national plan makaabot gyud dito sa probinsya, sa munisipyo o sa barangay. So ang naghimo ta og usa ka program nga we call that provincial consultative body, no? So kining provincial consultative body murag gihimo lang nato nga provincial level ang NAPC, no? Kay sa national level ang NAPC composed man siya sa 14 basic sectors, tapos sa mga 14 or more line agencies, no? And then ang president is the chairman of NAPC, and yours truly is the lead convener secretary, no? So ato lang ihimo nga provincial level ang structure sa NAPC by doing this provincial consultative body or PCB, no? So the structure of PCB is will be chaired by the provincial governor, and then co-chaired by the sectoral representative, no, sa probinsya, and then doon na po siya ay 14 basic sectors o doon na po itong mga line agencies, no? So ato lang gihimo na nga murag national sa provincial level. This PCB is the convergent consultative mechanism. It will serve as an avenue for collaboration and coordination between government agencies, primarily the LGUs and the communities, as well as mainstream the participation of people and civil society organizations in recommending, implementing, and monitoring anti-poverty programs and services. Okay. Now, I mentioned a while ago about the poorest of the poor. And we have identified 40 poorest provinces in the country, no? And actually, kinopya lang mo ni sa Climate Change Commission ng among among data, no? Nakita namo nga kining program nga Actionable Development Agenda for Poverty Transformation or ADAPT 40-10-10, kining 40 nga poorest provinces maupod ni ang mga probinsya nga usahay or pirming biktima sa mga natural calamities and disasters, no? So double whammy, kumbaga nga pobre na nga sila pero biktima gyapon sila sa mga calamities and disasters. So double dead. So we have to really focus on these 40 provinces. Unsa man ang mga 40 provinces? Doon na tayo i-present on ya, no? Ang number one gidiha na probinsya na pinaki poorest provinces are found in Mindanao. No? However, in Central Visayas, it's very unfortunate na doon ay na-appeal pod, no? Nga probinsya. And in top 10, kauban di ang Sikihor. Tapos sa top 20, I think kauban po ang Negros Oriental. No? So, later we will know the these provinces which are considered as the poorest of the poor, and these are also our targets in our program. Okay? And lastly, I think we have the reading materials also. Just yesterday, I signed a special order creating a program which will help us in the barangay, municipal, and cities to really popularize and, you know, seeing that all the development plans of the LGUs are in place and being implemented. We created a program which is called Kasambayanihan, Kaisa ng Sambayanan Laban sa Kahirapan, or Kasambayanihan. This is the National Anti-Poverty Commission Volunteer Program. So, briefly, I just want to state the guidelines, no, on how we are going to really make this program working on the ground. Ang among imo ondere, dunay sa barangay, dunay may mga i-recruit ng mga volunteers, no? Per barangay will be led by a team leader. And then, under him will be 20 to 25 volunteers. And then, kining mga core na 20 to 25 will also help households level in the barangay. Minimum households, that one volunteer will help is mga minimum ay mga 20 households gyapon or 25, no? Kana. So in a nutshell, mao na nang among imuon nga we hope that our fellow citizens will help us in really bringing down in the barangay level the benefits of our government, no? Kay daghang mga programa karon ang atong gobyerno pero wala nakaabot sa barangay, kay wala man gyud na popularize or walay mga naghatag og information, no? So this NAPC volunteer program is designed for us to help people on the ground, on the province, on the barangay level, that will give us the information, will give us the feedback whether or not ang mga development programs ba sa atong gobyerno nakaabot gyud sa ilaha. So I think doon na mo'y papel na pwede ninyong basahon kung sabi ninyo na Kasambayanihan or the NAPC Volunteer Program. Okay? So, I think I have done my part and I am now open for questions. Daghang salamat. Maayong hapon kaninyo tanan. It really requires funding, both from the national and local government units, no? So, as of now, dili lang ko ka kung sunod din mo pangutana na how much. Actually, sa among plan, doon na nami gibutang na mga budgets, no? But we are still not ready as of now. But I'm sure we really need funding, both from the national governments and national, at the local government units.
So far, sir, what is the estimate, sir? Like, estimate lang.
Estimate. For the farmers, actually, one of our programs is to advocate for sustainable agriculture, or particularly katong ginatawag natong organic farming. No? And our plan is to put up 5 or more organic plants or organic processing plants, no, in the country, in the whole country, no. Each plant that will produce organic fertilizer will cost mga 500,000 to 1 million pesos. So if we put up 6 plants, then we need more or less 6 million, no? That's for the organic farming. For the coconut farmers, we are also proposing to put up integrated coconut processing plants. No? These processing plants will produce virgin coconut oil, coconut skim milk, coconut sugar, coconut flour, and other products. We are not only limited to copra, in other words. No? And in our estimate, each plant will cost 75 million. So if we put or establish or construct 3 plants, no, processing plants, then 75 million times 3. Kila na?
225 million.
And there are other projects. For example, if we talk about the urban core, no, as of now, ang estimate sa HADCI, by 2022, doon ay backlog ng housing units sa Pilipinas na 6 million plus units. Okay? So kung ato nagapason ang 6 million units, per unit na lang, kung mag-cost na og 500,000 times 6 million units, that is the cost, estimated cost for constructing low-cost housing or socialized housing for our poor people in the country. So kana. There are other projects, pero I'm not yet ready to say the estimated cost.
Thank you, sir. Rosalie first. Sir, one of the mandates na ito na-mention kanina is to develop microfinance ng mga capability and the People's Development Trust Fund. Can we talk more on unsa na ta ka, how far have we gone in any areas, sir?
Yes, thank you for that question. Actually, to tell you frankly, doon natin akong problema, ani, no? Nga naman. Kay, according sa law, doon ay 4.5 billion unta nga pondo ihatag sa national government through
PAGCOR.
No? Through PAGCOR. Nga gamiton para sa atong microfinance activities. Apan, since 1998, the law was passed in 1998, until now, akong naaabtan na only 100 million ang naa sa Land Bank of the Philippines para sa microfinance. And then, kining resulting People's Development, kining People's Credit and Finance Corporation, long time ago, gidissolve na pud ni. So, doon na tayo akong problema, ani, no? Nga, I am trying to revive. Kay, personally, ako yun, nakita na ko nga, dako kayo ni nga ikatabang sa atong mga kubre, labi na sa mga those who are willing and dreaming to have their own livelihood projects, but ang problema walay kapital, pero kay wala sila makuhaan og kapital, so wala na lang, di ba? But we are reviving this kind of facility, and I hope that our national government will be positive enough to assist us on, along this line. No, nga mabalik, matagaan yun ang taog 4.5 billion, dako ito nga kwarta, no? Para sa microfinancing, para sa atong mga kabos. No? For example, our farmers, kung sabay problema karon sa atong mga mangunguma, ang dakong problema is, it is a business, but a losing business. No, ang mag-farm ka, business man na. Diba? Pero losing business, kay ang mahal kayo ang inputs para paghimo o pag-produce o palay, pero ang yield ubos o usahay pa, kung ibaligyan ang palay, barato. Pero ang bugas, mahal. Muna ang problema nato, no? So, kung saan na ito pagtabang sa atong mga mamumuma, amo, ginapropose ko na mo that the national government must subsidize. Dili tanan, but then ang pinaka-importante, katong sa fertilizer. No? And we encourage the use of organic fertilizer. That's why katong among proposal ganiha nga maghimo o mga organic plants. No? Processing plants. So, kung doon na unta ni microfinance, dili na maglisod ang atong mga farmers. But then, doon ay sa laing mga agencies karon, doon ay mga ano po, mga easy credit. For example, the Department of Agriculture, doon na sila ay easy credit para sa atong mga mangunguma o sa atong mga fisher folks. No? So, even without this money, I think our people can still avail the easy loan with our government in the Department of Agriculture. Doon na po mga loan po ang DTI, doon na po the money or financial assistance ang dole. No? Kana.
Wala pa na to na revive
ang
national programs. Do we look at partnering with these national line agencies?
That's why, kato nga akong insulti ganiha, nga even wala pa ni, doon ay other mga financial assistance or easy credit nga facility nga pwedeng ma-avail sa atong mga mangunguma, sa atong mga mananagat, o atong mga urban poor, no? Sa DTI, sa DA, sa DOLE.
So the 4.5 billion, to clarify na sir, the 4.5 billion is dapat makuha sa kaning microfinancing from PAGCOR every year or...
Oo. Actually, ano na na, unta, dugay na na nga na comply na ng 4.5 billion. Pero sa among paghibalo, only 100 million lang yun ang na credit, no? For this kind of facility.
Which is forced through land bank.
Sa land bank karon ang kwarta.
So those people who would want to avail of this kanang credit ko answer, how would they do it? Like, would they apply for under land bank?
Dili pa nato mahatag ni sa atong mga basic sectors kay we need to really revive the plan. No? Wala pa yun siya. The money deposited with land bank is I think na standby fund lang na karon. So ang purpose yun niya, wala yun siya na panghatag for microfinance activities sa atong mga basic sectors. So, mao pa na among maningkamot pa mi nga
ma-disperse
na. Pero we need to coordinate pa sa daghang mga ahensya, labi na sa Land Bank o sa Department of Finance.
There are still many indigenous people begging for us in the state. Do you have any specific program for these people?
Para sa mga indigenous peoples, dire sa Cebu actually, kana sila mga badyaw na eh. No? We need to know the history why these people are coming here in Cebu. No? Gikan din sila sa may tawi-tawi and hulo. And sila, kini mga, ano ni, mga sea gypsies, di ba? Nagapuyo ni sa dagat. Nga nung naasar karun na rin sa Cebu, pinakasimpleng explanation, wala na ipagkakitaan dito sa ilang lugar. No? Even mangisda sila, wala na sila makuha ng mga isda. Kay, although, under the law, doon ay 15 kilometer nga ginatawag nga municipal waters. Pero, many times, this law is violated. No? Kaya mga commercial fishing, mga fishers, no? Mo encroach man sa 15 kilometer nga limit unta nga dili sila pwede. So, unsa may problema karon nga nganong gamay na lang man ang makuha ng isda is because overfishing. Tapos plus, doon na pa'y problema ana nga kining showing degradation, no? Environmental degradation kay because of our multiple human activities, no? Na sahay bitaw. Mabitaw na akong gustong ipaambit yun nga. Kinahanglan kita mga Pilipino, we need to change our mindset in how on how to look at garbage or mga rubbish, no? Is concern. Kay kadaghanan ng mga Pilipino pa, wapag yun nagmataba nga, puro na lang labay-labay na lang ta sa atong basura. Hangtod ang mga basura na to, mga kadaghanan pa plastic, muabot og dagat. So, karon polluted ang atong dagat, so what do you expect? Doon na pa ba isda nga mabuhi sa atong polluted na dagat? Wala na. So, that's the reason why nga, kini mga badyaw, no, kay wala namang yun sila source of livelihood dito sa ilang area. Ni arena diri sa Cebu kay ilang pagtuo nga kining Cebu paradise nga dunay mga economic activities nga pwede sila mabuhi, pero nakita man nato nga they ended up begging, no? So ang among proposal gyudi ha, we have to link with the BIPAR, no? Do na may programa karon ng BIPAR kini pag-establish o pag-operate sa at least pag-operate o community fish landing centers or CFLC, no? So kung dito sa Tawi-Tawi and Hulo, we need to make representation with the BARN, the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. Na kinahanglan, mutabang ang government sa atong mga fisher folks, labi na sa atong mga badyaw. Kay kung once nga doon na ay source of living or source of livelihood karon ang mga badyaw, I think they will not be forced to go here in Cebu, no? They will just remain in Tawi-Tawi or in Hulo. Kay buhi naman sila dito, no? In other words, ang dapat na tabangan sila sa ilang mga livelihood, no? Sa Tawi-Tawi o Hulo, kinahanglan siguro i-improve pa ang katong seaweeds farming, di ba? Pero we have to make representation pa sa bagong Bangsamoro government. Kay doon na naman sila ay ginatawag ng autonomous region. And I'm very much optimistic nga kining bagong autonomous region will be able to lift up the living condition of the poor in the area. No, kay kabalo na mga ining kini karon ang barn is led by the MILF, and we know MILF, it's a rebel organization. No, they really laid down their lives for the sake of changing the status quo, and they really are determined to provide the comfortable life for all Bangsamoro in the region. So dako kayo nga akong pagtan-aw nga dunay kabag-uhan yun na diya sa barn. So eventually kung duna na maayong kinabuhi plus ang peace and order, maayo na dito sa arm area or barn area, kining atong mga igsuon ng mga badyaw, mubalik na sila dito. Kay kaluoy sila dito eh, no? Mga beggar sa mga sila.
Hey, ako ba yun karun, sir? Mga yun na ako, limos, kay para kung hindi kipauli. Oo naman na rin nila. Ito na lang itong budos.
No. Bito, tuloy, na-involve ko anak nila, katong commissioner pa ko sa National Commission on Indigenous Peoples. Diri kaayo, daghan ko kayong mga na-meet na diri. Nga in fact, ang atong local government unit diri sa Cebu City, dako kayo ang gitabang na nila. Ang atong mga civil society organizations, NGOs, gitabangan na sila nga doon na sila balay diha sa Mambaling. Oo. Dunag yun, ilan yun kaugilingon nga balay, ha? Gitagaan pa na sila o livelihood. Pero sahay bitaw, madang kung sulti ka niya nga kinanglan, dun ay pagbago sa mindset ba. Kay para nila, murag kung maglimos, murag easy money man para nila, so dito sila sa easy money. No? Pero, dili na sustainable, of course. And, nakadaot na sa ilaha, no? So, moto ang mga sulting, kinahanglan, ayuhon gitong ilang lugar dito sa Sulo at Tawi-Tawi. So, and then ang peace and order, ayuhon po, then tingali, mubalik din na sila dito sa ilang lugar.
Sir, question, sir. Kining creation and rule out of provincial conservative kailangan pa ba ding legislation sa local level sa para ma-organize or ma-formalize, considering na we have also existing mga local bodies, legislative bodies sa provincial level.
Ako ay believe na dili na kinanglan o local legislation, kay gihimo naman namo as program sa national, no? In a way, kini dili man sila mo pasar o mga balaod, kini rin consultative mechanism naman eh nga madungog ang mga recommendations or mga complaints, no? Sa atong mga 14 basic sectors, sa atong mga line agencies. Ang implementing arm ang NAPC. Tapos with the assistance of the provincial government and line agencies.
NAPC yapon sir, mag-cascade ali.
Yes, NAPC yapon.
Ano si role sa DALG
niya? Good question. Ang DALG in support of that, kay doon na ngayon actually gipagawas nga memorandum circular si Secretary Anyo nga ang tanang mga local government units from the province to the barangay must support the program of NAPC. So doon na. Wala lang tayo copy, no? Wala na to na...
Wala na. I-send na lang na mo.
I-send na lang na mo. Doon na ay memorandum circular ang DILG addressed to all governors, mayors, and barangay chieftains.
Kung sa pato, sir, di mong question din yan? Kung sa pato?
Actually, available sa Facebook page lang.
Katong memorandum circular di ay available sa among
Facebook page.
Facebook page sa NAPC. So, doon mo ay mga Facebook, pwede ninyong
makopya
dito sa among Facebook page. Ano sa'yo pangalan?
NAPC.ph
NAPC.ph
sa Facebook.
Sa among Facebook account.
Not for easier reference, we can also send you a copy of the PowerPoint. Kasi sa bayanihan, mas ano magod siya, kanang consolidated.
Asa na itong, ano, itong 40, pwede maano? Atong ipre. So, ano na rin ha? Ang ano na mo? Batay po siya sa UN Sustainable Development Goals. Tapos sa EDP 2017 to 22 at saka sa ambition na natin 2040. Sige. Maliw. Ano? So our target, actually the target is to alleviate poverty and lift up 6 to 8 million Filipinos by the end of the term of the president. So it kini ang general target. So 2019, we are into social preparation. Kung sa man ang social preparation, mga coordination with the line agencies, coordination with the local government units, no?
Information campaign.
And then information dissemination campaign. And then by 2020, we are hoping that there will be 500,000 Filipinos which will be lifted up from poverty. And then 2021, 1 million. And then 2022, 1.5. And then by 2023, 3 million. You might be questioning us why sa 2023, na that's the end of the term of the president sa 22, no? We would like to impress here that there is a need for continuity in the government. No? Unta, mawala na tong mindset na to ba? Nga kung bago ang presidente, bago na po ang iyang programa. So we want to impress and to convince all Filipinos that this kind of program must continue in order for us really to achieve the target. Sige.
Kine,
ang sambayanihan niya, no, believes na kung ang national government nitubag sa 10 basic needs sa katauhan, kaya yun na mawala na ang kalisod or kapobrehon. So, unsa man yung mga 10 basic needs, no? Food, tapos alit niya ang land reform, potable water, shelter, work, livelihood, health, tapos education, social protection, healthy environment, peace, and people's participation. So, mani ang detalye actually sa mga among gina-suggest ng mga programs. So, doon ay mga examples sa doable projects. Kining saling tubig project karon ongoing na ni. It is handled by DILG and NAPC. Tapos, sige, please.
Next
slide.
ongoing nga po ng community fish landing centers. This is a joint program or project of BPAR and NAPC. Sige. Sige, please.
Next. Go, go.
Sige. Actually, may himuon ming karaban. Ang karaban, tagang mga national line agencies o local government units mo uban sa paghatag o direct basic services sa ato katawhan, labi na dito sa mga lugar nga wala na servisyuhan o kung na servisyuhan man, kulang. No? Wala. Then, sige.
Yeah.
Sige, aman na.
Next. There.
So, kini, dili lang ay klaro, no?
Naaman sa sila.
Nasakit
nila.
Nasakit. No? Katong 40 provinces which are considered poorest.
Sige na.
Okay.
Okay na ba? Okay.
Isa, nakuman naman ako.
So, other question. Kami na-agree sa lista, sir. In order na sa one, ilang ranking can be.
Oo.
Ang pinaka-purest, ang Llano del Sur.
Tama.
Oo. Kaya, tanawin, i-check ko lang ha. Ah, kini. Yes, kini.
Arrange ni.
Number one yun na pinaka-purest, ang Llano del Sur. Tapos sunod, Maguindanao. Tapos number three, sa Visayas, Northern Samar. And then number four, Mindanao na po. Number 5, Sulu. Tapos number 6, Bukidnon. And then number 7 gani, Tocato de Reyes sa Central Visayas, no? Ang Sikihor. Then number 8, Zamboanga del Norte, Sultan Kudarat, Agusan del Sur. So, ang top 10 majority gikan sa Mindanao. No? Doon na lay usa na taga aduwa ka Visayas, no? Sikihor o Northern Samar. And then, ang atong Negros Oriental, number 14, ang iyang ranking. Okay. Cebu, actually, wala sa poorest of the poor. Pero, ato nang tanawon, kung mamutana ta, dato na ba ang mga tao sa Cebu, sir? Unfortunately, ang akong tubag niya, daghang pobre sa Cebu. No? Kay kung atong tanawon, ang Cebu dunay poverty incidence nga 21.4%. However, ang magnitude of poor population, kita ang number one sa tibuok Pilipinas, kay doon na tayo 986,557. Nga naman eh, kay nakuha na to ang poverty magnitude nga 986,557, kay ang poverty incidence nga 21.4%, atong gitimes ang total population sa Cebu. Karon ang Cebu, doon na estimated na 5 million na katawo. So, dako kayo sa Cebu. Sa Cebu. Tibuok Cebu. So, in fact, even sa voting population, number one niya po ang Cebu. No? Kaya doon na tayo 3,083,000 voters.
no, for this 2019 election. Ano? So ang Negros Oriental doon ay 45% na poverty incidence. Taas niya. Kaya ang atong national poverty incidence is only 21.6. Ang Bohol, taas po, pero gamay-gamay rapot kay iyang poverty incidence is 26%. Ang Sikihor, 52.9%. That's the reason why
more than half.
Number 7 siya sa top 10. So, naama na sa inyo ang kit?
Na.
Nasa inyong kit, no? So, kung atong diskutan ang Region 7 or Central Visayas na poverty incidence, doon na tayo 27.6% na poverty incidence, and then magnitude of the poor, doon na tayo 2,057,479 na pobre dere sa Pilipinas, sa
Region 7.
Sa Region 7. Sa Cebu City, taas gyapon ang poverty incidence, no? Kay doon na tayo 23.5%. This is as of 2015, ha, survey. By the way, I'm very excited to know kung ansa na yung poverty incidence sa Pilipinas karon, kay doon na yung 2018 na poverty incidence, kay nag-give na sila og survey, pero mugawas pa ang survey result by March 21 this year. So excited ko kayong makita kung doon na ba'y pagkunhod sa poverty incidence nasyonal. Kung doon na, at least maingon na ito na doon ay mga effective interventions na gihimo ang atong Duterte administration, ang kasubo na nato na kung mitaas. No? So we need to really ask ourselves and the government kung effective pa ba itong interventions, no? Kung mutaas. Now, I just hope and pray na unta ni ubos. Kay ang target mangyod ni President Duterte by 2022, mahimo na lang 14% ang poverty incidence sa Pilipinas. Okay?
Napay questions?
Napa?
Satisfied na lang.
Ano na, satisfied naman.
Tapos natubag ka lang.
With that, we thank everybody for joining us in the press of today.
Thank you.
Thank you.